We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
I am happy to join with you today in what will go down in history.
Good morning and welcome again to Faith on the Frontline here on LATalkLive.com. I'm Pastor William Monroe Campbell, co-host with our executive producer, the Reverend Dr. Louis E. Logan II. Dr. Logan is also pastor of York Christian Community Fellowship, and I pastor the Mount Gilead Missionary Baptist Church. We're excited today because we have two very special guests in our studio with us. We have Shannon Braxton, a radio personality from Baltimore, Maryland, and Ali Simon.
Thank you.
Who is a native here from Los Angeles.
Absolutely. LA, homegrown.
So we're delighted to them. Tell us a little bit about you, Shannon.
Oh, a little bit about me. That would take all hour, Reverend Campbell.
Okay.
But I'm a pastor's daughter. I don't know if you know Reverend Ronald Eugene Braxton from Metropolitan AME Church in Washington, D.C.
Okay.
I am his daughter and Reverend Marie Phillips Braxton, who is his wife and my mom. So I am no stranger to the church. And I, for the past couple of years, have been back in Baltimore, my hometown. I just got back out to L.A. hoping to be back on the mic. So okay,
very good.
That's me.
All right. And Ali, tell us a little bit about you.
Well, as you guys already said, I'm an L.A. native, and I am just floating in this universe, enjoying every day, feeling blessed and just content, just happy to be here and just figuring out what's next. Really.
All right. Very good. We have been sensitive to the fact that this month is noted as Women's History Month. Last month, we observed African American History Month. And in both instances, we recognize that our historical experience and our making of history is not limited to one month. It's 365, 24/7, and 366 in leap year. And so we're delighted to receive in our audience persons who can speak for themselves.
Amen.
So rather than demonstrate my chauvinism and my patriarchal orientation, let me back out of the way.
Oh, okay.
And have opportunity to hear from the ladies.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. So actually, this morning, we wanted to switch it up a little bit. Now, I know that we are on a Christian radio station, but what we wanted to do was play some songs that we could discuss issues based off of. The first one, I'm going to let it be a surprise, and we have DJ Ali Simon
hey,
on
here
the
we
mic
go.
Right here. All right, we're going to listen to this song, and then I want to talk about, you know, the issue, the main issue that's going to come up.
Okay. As we do that, let me say, because I'm sure the station owners, while we would lay claim to everything as Christians, as coming as pastors, but the station itself, LA Talk Live, is not limited to the Christian community.
Oh, right.
And so we as pastors seek to address all of the issues that impinge upon and impact anyone and everyone.
Absolutely.
And then this station lays host to persons of diverse kinds of backgrounds. But again, we look to hear from you as you share with us on Faith on the Frontline.
Absolutely.
Your challenges are a young group from Houston. Welcome Beyonce, Latavia, Nina, Nikki, Kelly, and Ashley, the hip-hop rapping Girls Time.
What you want to check?
Don't forget it.
did my shit. Bow down, bitches. 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 H-town, bitches. H-town, bitches. I'm so proud, proud. Bow down, bitches.
We teach girls to shrink themselves, to make themselves smaller. We say to girls, you can have ambition, but not too much. You should aim to be successful, but not too successful, otherwise you will threaten the man. Because I am female, I am expected to aspire to marriage. I'm expected to make my life choices, always keeping in mind that marriage is the most important. A marriage can be a source of joy and love and mutual support. But why do we teach girls to aspire to marriage and we don't teach boys the same? We raise girls to see each other as competitors, not for jobs or for accomplishments, which I think can be a good thing, but for the attention of men. We teach girls that they cannot be sexual beings in the way that boys are. Feminist, a person who believes in the social, political, and economic equality of the sexes.
You wake up, post up, round round in it, blossom on it. This diamond, my diamond, this rock, my rock. I woke up like this, I woke up like this. We flawless. Ladies, tell them I woke up like this. I woke up like this. We flawless. Ladies, tell them, say I look so good tonight. Goddamn, goddamn, say I look so good tonight. Goddamn, goddamn, goddamn. Mama taught me good home training. My daddy taught me how to love my haters. My sister told me I should speak my mind. My man made me feel so goddamn fine. I'm flawless. Wake up, post up, round round in it, blossom on it. This diamond, my diamond. This rock, my rock. I woke up like this. I woke up like this. We flawless. Ladies, tell them I woke up like this. I woke up like this. We flawless. Ladies, tell them, say I look so good tonight.
Judges give champion Skeleton Crew 4 stars. A perfect score the challenger Girls Time receives 3 stars. Skeleton Crew, champions once again. Congratulations. We'll see you next week.
Okay, so that was it. That was Flawless off of Beyonce's latest CD. And
whoa.
Was that right?
Yes.
Latest CD.
Yes.
Okay. And so actually, Reverend Campbell, I don't know if you know this, but there was this whole online internet debate about that being a feminist anthem.
Okay.
And I know you know what's up with that. I mean, go
well,
ahead.
Well, I mean, I guess it goes back and forth a little bit between, well, I mean, and I kind of straddle the middle a little bit where one part of it is, okay, is it okay to celebrate women in this way? To, you're like basically, is Beyonce, you know, down talking any of the other women in the industry or any other women by referring to herself basically as like the bad bitch or some way, and everyone else should bow down to her? Or is it a way to celebrate? Like, women should actually feel empowered and feel excited and thrilled to be on top and excited. And just as they said, you know, women are also often taught to be competitors, whereas men are actually able to be comrades in some way. So that's kind of where that the controversy of both sides kind of lie right now with this song. So
it's curious to me that you say that men are taught to be comrades, and yet our entire life is developed on the sports field.
Yeah.
And so competition is an inherent part of the growth and development of men and any sense of aspiration. has included with it the sense of competition. I think that we have denied women the opportunity to be self-affirming. Mm-hmm. And in our denial Absolutely. Of women to be self-affirming, and as we have lifted up the issue of submission before them, that I'm hearing a response to that says, I'm a person. Because I'm a person, I'm not subject to somebody else's definition for me, and I can aspire to whatever I want to aspire to.
Right.
Yes. And, you know, I wanted to, when you said that, what came up for me was that, wow, you know, oftentimes men and women are held in these two black and white categories, but we have so much in common.
Yes.
So the same, and I feel like a lot of times men aren't able, they don't have the platform to express that what you said, that a lot of your formidable years, you were on the football field or the basketball court, and you were in a competitive relationship with all the other men. However, my question is that, do you feel like in this song, Beyonce talks about women having to compete against each other and being in that type of relationship for the sake of men. So we're trying to see who's the baddest one for the sake of men. Do you feel like the same thing happened with men, where you're competing for the sake of women?
I think it goes in a different kind of way. I think that men compete for women, but they don't look at the other man when they're competing for the woman. Their focus is on the woman they are seeking to draw into a relationship with themselves. I hear you saying that women, on the other hand, are really eyeing it out with each other as they're competing for a man. So there's a different set of dynamics that
yeah,
are
absolutely.
Operating.
I think that's where that lies a little bit. And it makes total sense that you say that now and actually kind of look at that, where the man isn't necessarily focused on the other men. They're just focused on, you know, getting this woman. Like, I want to go for this woman. But
yes, I think we all feel the same way. I mean, that yes, women, we're going for this particular person, but we get really occupied with all the other women around us that could possibly be competing for this person as well. And so then we don't develop these loving sisterly bonds and relationships because we're always each other's competitor.
Right. Yeah, you make your sister your adversary.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And it becomes like a self-esteem sort of thing that actually happens. And I think it continues to go throughout different communities and different identities where it's always about this self-esteem thing, where no one's actually wanting to actually just come out and say, hey, there's a self-esteem problem. But
and that's for men too, though, right? Like, I know you say that your focus is on the woman, but don't men have times where they look around to the left and the right and say, well, dang, he's, you know, 6'5" and he's 6'1" and, you know, he's all cut up like this and he has, you know, all this beautiful hair or whatever. And it's, then you look at yourself. Y'all don't ever question y'all's self-esteem.
Well, thank you for allowing me to get into this debate.
Brother Van.
Yes.
There we go.
Not necessarily. If I see a young lady who's catches my attention and she's with another guy, that doesn't intimidate me, like, okay, because he's cut up and he has this, because all that is superficial. All that is outside appearance, because you can be, you know, the gentleman can be all cut up and looking like whoever, you know, that favorite person, that one person, but he's an ugly person on the inside.
Boom.
And then you can got this guy who's out of
there
shape.
Is.
You know what I mean?
But got a like good
job. Yep. Got a belly like me, but yet and still can listen to you and pay attention to you, where this guy who was so cut up couldn't care less. All he mm-hmm. has his own agenda. So, you know, it's always an exception to the rule. But you know, some guys may say, man, that's so gay, man. Why am I? I ain't trying to look at him. You know, I mean, I couldn't care less about him. You know. So.
In other words, the man is trying to build himself up in whatever kind of way, in terms of whether it's his physical appearance, whether it's money, whether it's his intellect, whether it's his rap. He's trying to build himself up to appeal to the woman, to draw her attention to him. And he's not necessarily dealing with trying to put the other guy down. What I'm hearing you say, and what I sense, is that women, on the other hand, have been geared to try to put the other woman down in order to appeal to the man's interest, and therefore in the process of putting the other woman down, they do injury to themselves.
Because we are all the same. Yeah. We are all one.
Right. I think that's only one part of it, though. Go ahead.
Yeah, and also that's ironic because I had a conversation with a young lady who was telling me that the relationship that she was in is not working out. And like I told her, I said, because she went, you know, her and our friends, I said, I don't really go around shooting a guy when he's down. But that should be like a red flag for you then, because if you're having some kind of complications with this person, you know, because I told her, I said, I hope everything is all right with the person that you're dating, that you're with, and all that. And she was nice enough to confide in me. And I told her, I said, well, you know, that might be a red flag. But like Reverend Campbell said, you know, I ain't shooting the guy. I ain't like, oh, well, then, yeah, I told you he wasn't no good from the start type response.
You're not saying it, but are you thinking it?
No, I couldn't care less. You know what I mean? Because that's on him. You know, that's some issues that he's going through with himself.
Well, let me just put out a disclaimer first that all women are not alike. All men are not alike. So, I mean, I'm the same way. You know, if someone is, I don't put down any other woman to each their own. And but some women do, right?
Absolutely.
Some women do.
Absolutely.
I think we've got, in terms of the biblical context, if I can share that, you've got the situation where you have Jacob competes with his brother Esau. And because he runs games on his brother and on his father, he has to leave town. And he goes to stay with his uncle Laban. And as he goes to stay with his uncle Laban, he discovers Rachel. Now, at that time, your cousin's married and that type of thing. And he falls in love with Rachel. And then he asks to marry her. But the next night, there were no indications of life. He wakes up and discovers that it's Leah. And then his uncle says, well, that's our way. The oldest goes first. And so then what you
hold
have,
up, Reverend Campbell, let me get something quick, real quick. So he gets into bed and he thinks he's about to sleep with Rachel.
Right.
But in the morning he wakes up and he finds out that wasn't Rachel.
Exactly.
That was Leah.
Exactly.
So they did a little switch up on him right at night.
Absolutely. And he says to his Uncle Laban, why do you play games with me? I wanted Rachel, but you gave me Leah. And Leah was not particularly attractive. And his uncle says, well, our way is that the oldest goes first. He says, well, what do I have to do to have Rachel? He said, well, you got to work 7 more years. He's already committed to work 7 years in order to have Leah. Now he's got to work 7 more years to have Rachel. He says, I'm crazy about her. If it takes 7 more years, 7 more years. Wow. And so he works 14 years. And then what happens is, and each of the ladies have their handmaidens. What happens is that Leah is conceiving and having children. Rachel is not.
Mm.
And Rachel gets upset with him because Leah is conceiving and having children and she is not. She says, well, I'll give you my handmaiden. You can have children by way of her. Leah says, okay, that work. I'll give you my handmaiden. Rachel still doesn't have any children. So Rachel, because she sees her objective as being a mother, because that's what the value was, is enraged. Finally, you know, she has a son, Joseph. There's also a daughter, Diana, that's born. And then she later dies in childbirth when she gives birth to Benjamin. But what do you have set up here? Jacob is presented dealing with the issue of his relationship with his uncle. Eventually, he deals with his relationship with his brother Esau. But all Rachel is left to deal with is whether or not she's able to mother a child through him. Therefore, the imagery of the woman is she lives for the man, whereas the man lives for all of these other things.
Mm.
And
right.
So within that context, then she's seeing her sister as an adversary. Mm. And that's the only imagery that's presented until such time as she gives birth. Whereas Jacob is dealing with his uncle, he's dealing with raising sheep, he's dealing with his brother. And so life is postured in a much broader way. And I think we have a carryover from that in terms of how we have postured women to see themselves. And I think certainly in recent history, and even the celebration of Women's History Month gives us a reason to say, hey, women are about more than simply satisfying the interests and the needs of men.
Amen. And so with that, I would like to read a poem by Nikki Giovanni, Ego Trippin'.
Yes.
Y'all know this one? Y'all know this one? Okay. All right. I haven't read this in a long time, so bear with me. Ego Trippin' by Nikki Giovanni. I was born in the Congo. I walked to the Fertile Crescent and built the Sphinx. I designed a pyramid so tough that a star that only glows every 100 years falls. Into the center giving divine perfect light, I am bad. I sat on the throne drinking nectar with Allah. I got hot and sent an ice age to Europe to cool my thirst. My oldest daughter is Nefertiti. The tears from my birth pains created the Nile. I am a beautiful woman. I gazed on the forest and burned out the Sahara Desert with a packet of goat's meat and a change of clothes. I crossed it in 2 hours. I am a gazelle, so swift, you can't catch me. For a birthday present, when he was 3, I gave my son Hannibal an elephant. He gave me Rome for Mother's Day. My strength flows on forever. My son Noah built the new ark, and I proudly at the helm, and I stood proudly at the helm as we sailed on a soft summer day. I turned into myself and was Jesus. Men intone loving my name. All praises, I am the one who would save. I sold diamonds in my backyard. My bowels delivered uranium. The fillings, the filings from my fingernails are semi-precious jewels. On a trip north, I caught a cold and blew my nose, giving oil to the Arab world. Wow. The oil to the Arab world. I am so hip, even my errors are correct. I sailed west to reach east, and I had to round off the earth as I went. The hair from my head thinned, and gold was laid across 3 continents. I am so perfect, so divine, so ethereal, so surreal. I cannot be comprehended except by my permission. I mean, I can fly like a bird in the sky.
It sounds like the powerful Nikki Giovanni is reflecting her identity with Mother Africa.
Yes, absolutely.
One of the things that came forth with Nikki G and Angela Davis and others was, again, a self-affirmation that forced the world to look at them anew. It's almost like we didn't know who Nefertiti was, and we had Elizabeth Taylor portraying Cleopatra, and what they said is, look at me for who I am, and celebrate and respect. And rejoice in who I am, and that gives reason for not just womanhood but black womanhood to be appreciated and affirmed rather than condemned and rejected.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about black womanhood. So last night,
here we go.
Simon and I were in a little friendly debate about the new superstar on the front of every magazine.
Absolutely.
And on everybody's Facebook feed.
I bet if I open this magazine, Miss I could probably
Lupita,
find a picture.
Miss Lupita, now I'm not, you all
Nyong'o.
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 Miss Lupita Nyong'o. Yes. And now Lupita is, I'm sure everyone listening and watching knows.
You can't miss her. She's on everything.
She won the Oscar award for Best Picture for 12
Best Supporting Actress.
Best Supporting Actress.
The movie won the Best Picture, but she won Best Supporting Actress
for 12 Years a Slave. Was she up against Oprah? I didn't see it.
No, Oprah was not nominated.
Okay, so Lupita, how you feel about Lupita?
Oh, here we go. Well, you know, I have mixed feelings about everything, and I think she's amazing. She's beautiful. Her role was amazing. It's dynamic, you know, crossing all boundaries and borders and everything. But I sometimes get on the edge a little bit because I realize, like, every year it seems like there's a new African-American woman who society decides that we want to showcase, and, oh, they're the most beautiful person in the world, and parading them around and doing all of this. I'm like, really? every year it seems like there's a new person. So if we wait till next year, I'm sure there's going to be another one. But I think for the most part, I think she's amazing and she's really great. But then it also opens the issue like, okay, so if I think it's the same thing about how being a lighter complexion woman is we're always seen as more beautiful or we have a lot more, we get a lot more attention. And I get it for the most part that might actually happen in society. But then it's like every year there's a new woman who is a darker complexion, who's celebrated, who's just amazing for all of her work. But I don't feel like that happens every day in the world for lighter complexion women as well. Like, I just don't feel like, I feel like we shouldn't be categorizing, oh, because she's darker, she's more beautiful, she's an actress, she's doing all this. Like, why not just, because they're a great actress. Like,
well, I mean, I think that the reason why she has so much attention and so much attention is being drawn to her skin complexion, like her skin tone, is because it's striking and it's beautiful and it's amazing. And like
it
you
is.
See her and
can't
you're
deny
like,
that.
Wow, like you don't see that image of a African woman, as she's actually African Mexican, not African American, but you don't see that dark chocolate skin celebrated in the media, on magazines. I mean, we have Michelle Obama now, so we get to see her, but I don't see this happening too often. So when I do see it happening, I am excited and, you know, I can't get enough of looking at her.
I get it. I mean, I just feel like it happens. I guess I'm not one of those who thinks that it doesn't happen at all. Like, I do see it. Yes, I think black women in general across the board should have a little bit more attention than what we actually have. And not just, oh, because she has a darker complexion now or she has a lighter complexion. Like, I just don't see it as that everything should be separated in, oh, because we need to get more darker complexion or we have to go down the color scheme and actually pick one of these women out every year to actually celebrate. Which I just think, like, why not just grab, like, more African-American women, period. That's my whole opinion about it. But I think more than anything, the one thing that struck me the most about Lupita, once I heard her entire story, was that she's Mexican, technically. Well, not technically, she is.
She was born in Mexico, but she was born to Kenyan parents. She's Kenyan in terms of her heritage,
right.
Although she was born in Mexico, right. And then shortly after that went back to Kenya, then came back in her high school years to learn Spanish.
And that is amazing. That alone, I think.
Yeah, but there's some other issues. I preached a sermon called Praise God for Lupita, and I talked about the fact that she dealt with the issue of albinism. She dealt with the issue of HIV and AIDS. She dealt with the issue of premarital unprotected sex. Mm. She was addressing these issues before she gained the celebrity of 12 years a slave.
Amazing.
And then as she was presented in terms of the Essence Women Conference, she dealt with her own issues about skin color and then discovered as she looked at another beautiful African woman, that she could have a sense of beauty within herself, and therefore her sense of identity rose beyond her skin tone. She was able to affirm her skin tones, but she was also able to affirm her humanity. And that's the lesson that I'm picking up from Lupita, is having women and black women in particular to be able to affirm their humanity,
right.
And to live their lives with a sense of commitment. I heard her talking about her concern about helping every young girl to be able to dream her dreams and realize she could achieve her dreams. And I don't know to what extent that gets transmitted.
Wow, and that's beautiful. Like, that alone, like when I'm watching or reading different stories, it's always about her skin complexion. It's good to see a black woman's skin. But to hear that and to all of these amazing things that she's doing, that is what we should probably be putting out there, that sort of message to young girls and to all sorts of people, of this is what this woman has been doing before, leading up to this performance. That's amazing.
So what I hear your issue is that is the objectification of black women.
Absolutely.
So we're looking at her as, oh, she's a chocolate skinned woman. And then we're looking at light
skinned
women as, oh, she's a light skinned woman.
Yeah.
But she's a businesswoman as well.
Yes.
She's been a producer in the entertainment industry
Absolutely.
For years and years and years and years, and worked her way up to getting this acting spot and getting this part. But she's so much more than a dark skinned woman.
And has a master's degree from Yale School of Drama.
ahead, girl. Get your life.
Yeah, and I look at it, and this is just my opinion, when society or that type of business, it's like that affirmative action. You know, they want to put these type of women up front to say, okay, we recognize them. But like she was saying, the focus is not on the skill and the occupation of the woman. It's just, again, her skin color, because they are so caught up over so many years about that, from the Cotton Club and even earlier.
Absolutely.
That this is their way of saying, oh, okay, we politically correct.
We,
yep. You know, because for a long time, the darker skinned black women were not considered marketable, so they didn't get that opportunity. Now they're starting to allow that type of woman to be their poster child.
Right.
Exactly.
So they can say, like, yeah, I mean,
we have one, so let's do it. Yeah.
And next, and like you said, next year we're gonna have, because you know, United States is so, as I'm gonna put the phrase, they like the bricks on the wall behind you two ladies. They're so tight that the rest of the world is so more open.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they don't focus on the complexion or the person's skin. They what you got to offer,
exactly.
What you got to bring to the table,
yeah.
You know, because it's enough for everybody to eat. So,
yep.
Okay.
And I was going to just say that what you said about in other countries, how they actually look at women and who have, you know, your darker, they don't look at the skin complexion as much. I just remember when I was traveling in India, like I remember walking through and my sister and I were there, and I hadn't seen any other African-American black women while we were there. And I just remember being so celebrated for a long time. I remember in America before we left, they're like, oh my God, as black women, you guys are going to go travel alone. You're crazy. All this. And we got there and we were like worshipped. Like, the people there were just loving us and saying, you're so beautiful, you're all these things that I didn't even expect. But it's just so funny how in America we just are in this sort of situation where we'd allowed ourselves to just let's pick one new African-American woman to play the poster child, like you said. Like, for example, Gabrielle Sidibe a few years ago. She's a woman who is a heavier set woman and, of course, her darker complexion. So she's completely the different sort of woman. So we need to actually put her on the screens. So, but
my question to you is, though, how do you define yourself? Remember I said I wanted to sit back, and because my concern is for you to be able to define yourself. I guess all of my life I've had a resistance to accepting carte blanche, what the general society offers. And so I need to hear from you your definition of yourself, your definition of your personhood, you know, again, your aspirations. Okay, you're a radio producer. You know, how do you get to where you are, and what is the message for the younger girls and even the younger boys coming in behind you? Because we need to hear you and not let the society at large define you for us. You need to define yourself for us so we can appreciate you for the person that you are.
Well, I think all people, men, women, boys, girls, I think that it's important to recognize that we are all number one, regardless of any gender, sexual identity. We are children of God, right? If you're going to walk in that role, then that's your role, regardless of anything else. So I define myself, my name, I hyphenated my name to Shannon Eli Braxton, because I always wanted to remember that in the midst of whatever my plan is, my focus is to do what it is God has put me here to do. So as cliche as it may be, the only thing I define myself as is someone who has surrendered to the will of God. And about my womanhood, I mean, I think we wanted to play this song, Whitney Houston, because she sums it up the best, you know, Whitney and Chaka Khan, they said it the best. And so about my womanhood, I'm going to say that indeed I am every woman. And then I'm just going to let Whitney sing it. I'm going to try not to sing with her, okay?
That's all right.
Whatever you want.
Because we can do all things whatever through Christ who strengthens us.
Amen.
Some every woman.
Chemical Brothers, can you tell me that a woman has helped you feel better when you felt danger or fear? Naturally, a woman just helps you, right? If it was just your mama, that's what women are, right? Can you tell me that you've seen a woman cast a spell, even if it was just your mama, that we have supernatural powers, right?
You said you were a child of God. That's therefore, right. You are the instrument whereby the power of God radiates through
you. There you
so
go.
When you talk supernatural, let's put it in proper context. Mm-hmm. The supernatural is, in fact, the reflection of God at work in you and through you.
That's right.
And so my concern is to bring it out of the code language of the church. Mm-hmm. and translate it so people understand. When you say you're a child of God, what are you saying about yourself?
What I am saying is that I am all powerful. I can do things that I don't even know that I can do.
So you're discovering who you are. You're discovering your possibility. You're allowing the power
every
of God
day.
To manifest
the
power of himself in you and through you. And so that's what we need to be able to celebrate. When I hear Ego Tripping by Nikki Giovanni, and when I hear I'm Every Woman by Whitney Houston, I hear somebody getting in touch with their possibilities, and their possibilities are there because of what God has endowed and imbued them with. And therefore, we don't need to let anyone else restrict you from your possibilities.
That's right. Absolutely. And on that note, I want to talk about a couple of women who have grabbed that power. And one of them, who I admire so much, is Miss Jada Pinkett Smith.
Yes.
Jada's from Baltimore, and I'm from Baltimore, and so watching her leave Baltimore, get out of Baltimore City, and move out here to LA and become so successful, and to me, the most successful thing she has done professionally so far is produce this movie, the Free Angela Davis film. And I have not had the pleasure of seeing it, but Free Angela and All Political Prisoners was a documentary that chronicles the life of young college professor Angela Davis and how her social activism implicates her in a botched kidnapping attempt that ended with a shootout, 4 dead, and her name on FBI's 10 most wanted list.
Yes.
And she has been a political refugee for I don't know how many years, but...
No,
many,
she's
many.
Been freed up. She's no longer college. She's teaching at UCLA.
She's here. I didn't know.
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
Angela's one of the foremost teachers.
I didn't know Angela Davis was here at UCLA.
Yes.
Well, how long was she a refugee? Y'all fill me in, because I haven't seen the movie and I don't know what's going on. So fill me in.
I'm trying to chase back into my head, but it seems to me like it was like 5 to 7 years
she was
in that
in Cuba. Is that right?
State. Yes, mm-hmm. In the refugee state.
And then she got back in, but did I hear something about her name was back on? Who is it that's still that I'm thinking of? It's not Angela Davis. That's still a political refugee, and her name recently reappeared on. She's in Cuba. She has long locks. Her name recently reappeared on the FBI's 10 most wanted list again. Okay, I'm not connected online, but somebody, if anybody's listening, call in, because I know somebody knows who I'm talking about. I often get her mixed up with Angela Davis, but she is in Cuba right now.
323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. Call in.
And while we're waiting for somebody to call in and tell us about that, We also wanted to shout out a couple of other women. One of them is Queen Latifah.
All right.
So Queen Latifah, I mean, she's every woman right now, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I mean, if you look at, you know, where she's come from, you know, I mean, where she comes from, where she's able to, initially she started off as this rapper from the East Coast, and just, you know, one of her songs was, you know, the who you calling a, I don't, oh, UNITY.
UNITY.
Exactly. And to where she is now, where she's on, you know, the front, where she's now taking over Oprah, where she's, you know, the person we see on television, on live television across the nation. Like, she's really kind of grabbed it by by the chokehold and is like, I'm going to make this happen. I'm going to actually rise up. I'm going to show women what it's like, how beautiful it is. And that just brings me back to what we were talking about. The second issue of that Beyonce song we initially played at the beginning was there was one part where I said that, you know, there's this thing about how women view themselves and they shouldn't be competitors. And the other part was, is it okay and is it appropriate for them to actually feel empowered and to go above and beyond and thrive? And I absolutely believe in that completely. I, for myself, like, I just believe that, you know, as long as you are grounded in yourself, grounded in your spirituality and in God, and you know that anything is possible, that, I mean, that's where we go from here. Did you find that, Refugee?
I'm still looking. Once I say her name, everybody's going to say, oh, how could we forget about Sister such and such, who has been down there because she was associated with the Black Panthers back in the early 70s. Right. So we're going to figure that out. But within the next 13 minutes, we're going to definitely figure that out before we get off the air. Okay. So what else do we want to talk about? We also wanted to shout out to Kerry Washington, right? Who is the main face of Scandal. Is that a big deal? I don't watch Scandal.
You know,
but
right now,
a Black woman in that role, that's a big deal, right?
Yeah, I mean, it is a very, very Black, a very, very big role to actually have, especially being that we don't see it a lot. And like we always say, we were just talking about, we just don't see it a lot. And to have, I remember recently how Shonda Rhimes had actually won that a diversity award for actually displaying, you know, these powerful African American roles on a lot of her productions. And when she got up there, she did make a comment, and I'm not quoting her completely. She made a comment about how she was honored to actually receive the award, but she was just really upset the fact that, you know, that she actually has to receive an award for being diversity, of doing something that everybody else should be doing. So yeah, I just thought that was really interesting. But I think she's, you know, Shonda actually is amazing, how she's really kind of pushed herself to the limits and really gone above and beyond what actually, you know, is usually being seen in, you know, society today. So I actually want to celebrate her. Even though Kerry Washington is great, I just think that the work behind the scenes is actually almost just as great than what we actually
absolutely
see.
Absolutely. And it's Asada Shakur.
Asada Shakur. There you go.
Yeah. Nice. So... Yeah. Shout out.
Yeah, absolutely. Did you... Go ahead. No. Did you want to actually move into the next song, or would you...
Oh. We wanted to play one more song for you, Pastor mm-hmm. Campbell, and see what you think about this. Wait a minute. Now, I don't know if this is the censored version. Is this the censored version?
You know what? I don't know.
Okay. But even if you got kids listening, they know the words anyway.
Oh.
how does it make y'all feel when you hear a song like that when we say we run the world?
I'm a father with two daughters, so.
You already know. Yeah,
and also a son, but two daughters. Yeah. One of the most insightful experiences I had was when my oldest daughter was access student at the University of California in San Diego. She called me one day and she was sharing some problems she was dealing with, and I was trying to offer some insight about how to solve it. And she said, "Daddy, I don't need you to give me a solution. Mm-hmm. I just need you to be able to hear me.
To listen, exactly."
And so what she was saying is she wasn't calling for me to protect her, mm-hmm. but to stand with her. Good. As she was able to do what she needed to do.
Way to go.
For herself. And obviously that took me back, because my disposition as husband and father and even pastor
is to protect.
You know, exactly. I protect my wife, I protect my daughters, I protect my congregation. And she was saying, "I don't need you to protect me. I just need to know I have the strength of you standing with me as I give expression to, if anything, you've already invested in me. I'm able to handle things for myself." So when you talk about we run the world, for me that does not become threatening, but it's because the lesson's already been learned. Too often we don't have opportunity to learn that lesson, and so we become threatened because we fear displacement.
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely.
Yes. Okay.
Well, because I was raised by a single mother, and growing up with three of the five sisters I have and being the oldest, so no, I don't feel threatened either about women running the world or rule the world, because without you women, man would not exist.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a daughter who I'm very proud of, and like I've told people, at the age of five, I taught my daughter that boys walk on the outside, girls walk on the inside. And I would deliberately walk out of a building on purpose, and this five-year-old girl would say, "Dad, you on the wrong side." And she's 20, she'll be 23 next year, or next month. And if you're a gentleman, if you're a guy walking down the street with her, she'll tell you, "You need to walk on the outside, because you need to protect me at all times. I need to feel protected in my own way, you know, in that way." So yeah, as far as me coming on the tail end of your conversation, but yeah, I'm not threatened. I'm glad that women have that power and know that they have that power and know how to use their femininity in a way where we feel as though that, okay, we have the right woman next to us, with us.
Mm. And that should make you feel protected as well.
Of course, because now I know I know she's able to handle herself as being a woman and taking care of a woman, because that's then she shows me that she can be and she is my equal.
Amen. Amen. Well, let me just say this one thing. I mean, I'm not going to get on a soapbox about it, but as equals, one thing about that song, I love that song, and I call my homegirls, and I use the word girls a lot. But what I will say, which I told Allie this morning, is that I do not like in a professional atmosphere to be called a girl. Now, thank you. I know I, you know, have kept my youthful charm, but I don't want to be called a girl at work. Yes. I think it's rude and it's disrespectful.
Yes.
Right. So I just want to say that to everybody listening. If you call anybody in your office by the term girl, you are wrong. Stop doing it today and get in there and say, "I'm sorry. I respect you as a grown woman. I will not call you a girl again," because I'm sure she has tried to tell you that she don't like that.
I think what you're saying conveys the fact that too often we try to define people from our perspective and not appreciate their own self-definition.
Totally.
And what I hear you saying is that when I call you a girl, I'm looking at you out of my eyes.
Right,
I'm
it's patronizing.
Not appreciating your own self-definition. And part of the challenge before us is to appreciate each person's own self-definition. And to me, it doesn't become about equality. It becomes about affirming personhood. You see, because if I make you equal with me, and if I'm down here, look what I just did to you.
Right.
Okay, so I need to be able to appreciate you as the person you are, with the gifts, the talents, the potential, the flaws also that you have. And so as we have engaged throughout this month, and will continue to affirm the blessing of womanhood, it needs to be not a sense of toleration. It needs to be a sense of celebration.
Amen.
And so I leave these minutes for you to continue to share with us how to celebrate. Again, let me say on behalf of the Reverend Dr. Lewis E. Logan, our executive producer, that we're delighted that you have joined us on LATalkLive.com as we have shared in faith on the front line. And we are just utterly blessed today to have Shannon Braxton and Ali to be with us and to continue to share. And we continue to look to hear words from them as we celebrate the blessing of who we are, and just think of what we can be if we're not caught up in worrying about who gets the credit.
Exactly.
That's right. Ladies. Well, when we were preparing for the show, we called Reverend Logan and asked him, is it okay to play this Beyonce song? Because, you know, it has the B word in it. And we wanted to talk about that, though. And he said, well, yeah, go ahead and play it, because the real, this is a quote, the real B word is black, bold, beautiful, and oh so blessed. And we wanted to just end with a song to every woman, to every man who loves a woman, every man who has supported a woman, to every woman, you are beautiful. Thank you for having us on the air.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Have a wonderful day.
My life is brilliant. My love is pure. I saw an angel, of that I'm sure. She smiled at me on the subway. She was with another man, but I won't lose no sleep on that, 'cause I've got a plan. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful.
Thank you so much for having me on the air today, Reverend Campbell and Dr. Logan. Thank you so much. And if you want to find me on Facebook, I'm Shannon, S-H-A-N-N-O-N hyphen Eli, E-L-I, Braxton, B-R-A-X-T-O-N.
Thank you. And Allie?
Oh, and you can reach me on Facebook. I'm at Allie M. Simon. That's A-L-L-I-M-S-I-M-O-N.
Thank you. Again, on behalf of Pastor Lewis E. Logan, and I am again Pastor William Monroe Campbell, we thank you ladies for being with us, and we thank our audience for again being with us on Faith on the Front Line here at LATalkLive.com. Pastor Logan often says, don't just talk about it, be about it. We are world changers. We come here as people empowered of God to make a difference in His world. We find this world turned upside down, and our commitment is to be used of God to turn it right side up. And so to all of our audience, we say thank you again. Dan, thank you again, for keeping us together, and the blessings of God be upon you, rule and smile upon you as we move forward to His honor and His glory. God bless one and all.
You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. It's true. The most